What's up, guys? Let's talk about clams. Giant clams of the genus Tridacna are a popular mollusk in reef aquariums. Now, most people that aren't into this hobby are familiar only with their shells, and it's a bit of a shame because their true beauty can only be realized when they're living, as they have a brilliant mantle that's just stunning to behold. Tridacna clam mantles have intricate patterns and come in a variety of colors. I've seen clams that are purple, blue, green, yellow, and even some that have iridescent qualities. It's not difficult to understand why these clams are so popular in reef keeping today. Tridacna clams are found all throughout the Pacific. The four most readily available species of Tridacna clams are Dorasa, Squamosa, Maxima, and Crocea. In rare instances, one might find a true giant clam, Tridacna gigas. Here's a 30-year-old gigas at the Waikiki Aquarium in Hawaii. It was grown from a very, very small specimen, less than an inch or so, to this monster that weighs hundreds of pounds probably. There are actually two other species that are not in the aquarium trade, namely Tridacna tevaroa and Tridacna costata, which is a new species discovered recently in the Red Sea. Let's talk a bit about their anatomy. The mantles are filled with zooxanthellae, much like photosynthetic coral. Early in a clam's life, the quantity of zooxanthellae is limited, so they rely more on filter feeding. It's estimated that smaller clams get about 65% of their energy from filter feeding. Larger clams, however, only get about 34% of their total energy from filter feeding, indicating a much greater reliance on photosynthesis. As a general guideline, clams smaller than 3 inches would benefit from phytoplankton supplementation. Lighting is probably the single most important factor to consider when keeping clams. Second to lighting is the need to maintain tip-top water chemistry. High calcium and alkalinity are a must. Clams are known for very fast growth rates, and they deplete calcium and alkalinity aggressively to power this growth. This is why they tend to do better in tanks designed for corals like Acropora, which also require high light and ample supplies of major elements for calcification. As for flow, these clams prefer moderate water flow despite originating from shallow areas of the reef that receive heavy wave action. The concern with high flow in the aquarium is the risk of introducing bubbles into their bodies that the clam cannot effectively eliminate. Clams have two siphons that move water in and out of its body. There's a large inhalant siphon lined by these little fine tentacles you can see here. When it opens wide, you can actually catch a glimpse of the clam's gills. The gills of the clams are interesting in that they're used for both respiration and feeding. The water is then expelled through a smaller exhalant siphon. The exhalant siphon is also used to expel waste from the clam, as well as discharging sperm and egg for reproduction. At the base of the clam is a foot by which it attaches to substrate. There's also a byssal organ there that excretes thin byssal threads to anchor it into place. It's critically important that the aquarist does not damage the foot or the byssal gland by moving a clam from one place to another. It's very easy to damage the byssal organ, and if that happens, chances are the clam's not going to make it. Once a clam is anchored to a rock, it's best to move the entire clam and rock as one piece. Now that we've covered the common anatomical features of Tridacna clams, how do we go about telling the different clams apart? Let's start with Tridacna maxima and Tridacna crocea, because they're by far the most similar to one another. They both have these dazzling multicolored mantles. Now, the best way to tell them apart, in my opinion, is the shape of their shells. Maxima clams are slightly elongated in shape, while croceas are a little bit more stout and stubby. Also, maxima clams tend to have a more pronounced flute design on their shell compared to crocea clams that are just a little bit more smooth in texture. Tridacna dorasa are much easier to tell apart from other clams. Dorasa clams have a distinctive golden-colored mantle with streaks of teal and a vibrant blue rim. In comparison to Maxima and Crocea clams, Dorasa clams get massive. It's not uncommon to have a Dorasa grow to over 20 inches in a home aquarium. They're considered one of the most hardy clams, making it an ideal choice for a first-time clam enthusiast. That brings us to Tridacna squamosa. While less common than the other three clams, the occasional squamosa does turn up from time to time. Squamosa clams have muted coloration in comparison to Maximas and Crocea's, but have a very distinctive fluted shell. While Maximas, Crocea's, and Dorasa's have somewhat smooth shells, the squamosa has pronounced scales that are quite attractive in their own right. One day, I'd like to try to aquaculture clams. We are admittedly a long way off from doing anything like that, but they're such cool animals, and it's possible to get them to reproduce sexually by manipulating light, hormone levels, and chemical parameters in the water. Now, most of the places that are doing this now do it with mariculture setups out in the ocean or hybrid facilities on the coast. I think, however, in the next few years, there's going to be a lot of progress made on trying to grow clams inland, and I personally think that it would be a very exciting project. Anyhow, that does it for Tridacna clams. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Until next time, happy holidays and happy reefing.